Penguin Random House Audio presents This Body's Not Big Enough for Both of Us by Edgar Cantero. Read for you by January LaVoy. Elmore Leonard said it's bad style to open a novel with the weather. Well, fuck him. It was a blazing, red-hot August morning. The ceiling fan did little more than amuse the flies, many of which wandered up to the highest layer of the office's troposphere to burst into flame and fall spiraling down like wounded Zero fighters. The air was heavy with the smell of sulfur and interbreast sweat. It felt as if El Nino, California, and Satan were conspiring to push the city to the brink of spontaneous combustion. And then, like a high-heeled coup de grace, she arrived. She paused briefly outside the door, her hourglass silhouette cast upon the glass panel with the fresh, shiny vinyl letters reading, A. Kimrian, Z. Kimrian, Private Eyes. She knocked first, waited, then tried the handle, and the door surrendered to her touch. She wandered in like a fairy tale top model into a CGI forest, a flutter of long skirts and flaming red hair kiting behind her, a flock of freckles swarming her eyes like glistening lakes of, whoa, 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 okay, wait, wait, wait. Kimrian stops, stares dead at Detective Demoin across the interrogation room table. Demoin.
Sorry, just, can we dial down the poetry a notch? The narration's way too colorful.
Kimrian, shrugging. My life is colorful. Demoin.
Maybe play down the alliteration a little.
Kimrian.
Alliteration a little.
You know, your life could have been colorful too, Ted, but you chose the SFPD.
The thrill of paperwork and the flashy badges.
Demoin.
You need a badge to work as a PI, too.
Pause. Kimrian.
Sure. I was testing you.
Darkness prevented long, descriptive paragraphs. Blind, striped sunlight poured through the large windows across a vast, empty space navigated by intrepid motes of dust. The woman discerned a cleared desk to the right, smelled a bed in an alcove to the back left. In the middle of the room stood a high stool, or a very narrow table, dais-wise. Atop sat a chess set in mid-battle. Through a lateral door on the alcove's side, somebody, the slender, long-limbed ink sketch of somebody, stepped out, preceded by the sound of a flushing toilet, and stopped right upon seeing her. The woman barely made out an eye glistening in the dark, two hands wiping some rumpled clothes, a mouth greeting her.
Wow, you are hot.
The woman looked away, smoothed her dress, checked her hair, scratched her forearm, did another 30 irrelevant actions meant to summon her cool, and finally resumed speaking.
Are you the private investigator?
I can be whatever you want me to be. She pointed at the door, baffled.
The sign says, Private Eyes.
And you're so sagacious, I can't believe you're in need of one. The mouth drew a grin as shiny and sharp as a cutlass. The dame paused for a second while she realigned her expectations with the slim, beaming reality before her. It didn't match her platonic archetype for a private detective. The Spartan pay-by-the-week rental office she had anticipated. Also the fedora and the white tank top.
Maybe not the skimpy black waistcoat on top. But she was also expecting a square jaw, coarse stubble, the odd scar, a dark brow, the features of a man of action as defined in her mind by the cover art of some gritty paperback. The face watching her now was oval or ogive shaped. It had the featureless skin of a mannequin and the vigilant look of a small bird. The only visible eye, spotlit by an implausibly accurate stripe of blind-filtered daylight, was a lemony green. And whether the collection of parts added up to a man was still up for debate.
"I'm sorry, are you A. Kimrian or Z. Kimrian?"
The green eyes stared back at her, silent. Then the whole figure moved past her to the entrance, leaned out into the landing, looked both ways, and carefully closed the door.
"Are you okay?"
the woman asked, scowling at her host's frowsy appearance.
"Oh yeah," said the other, pointing toward the bathroom. "Much better now."
The same implausible light stripe fell on the right eye now. A gentle orange brown, like ale, peeking through bangs of straw-colored hair.
"Interesting."
Dimwan.
"No, it's not."
Kimrian shuts up, clearly offended by the unflattering review. Dimwan.
"You're recounting your sexy scenarios with red-haired women instead of explaining your role in this,"
reads notes,
"shooting, arson, and destruction of a police vehicle."
Kimrian.
"I'm giving you context. This is relevant."
Dimwan.
"How?"
Kimrian.
"It's a fundamental principle of private investigation. There's no yin without yang, no violence without love."
Dimwan.
"Zoe."
Kimrian.
"I'm serious. You wouldn't know because you're in the public sector, but it's a natural constant in my business. From the moment you rent an office on Fisherman's Wharf and spell your name and the words private eye in vinyl letters on the glass, only two types of people will go through that door. Femme fatales and necklace thugs coming to pummel your teeth in."
The detainee sits back, stick insect legs spread outward, exposing the irrefutable truth. Dimwan rubs his face. Dimwan.
"Can we just skip the redhead and start with the shooting?"
Kimrian sighs, frustrated.
"Fine."
Elmore Leonard said,
blah, 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 blah. It was a blazing, red-hot August morning. The fan on the ceiling did little to stir the gunpowder and brick dust suspended in the air, while a long-condemned second of calm died in the clangor of Kimrian blasting through the wall, an avalanche of plaster and bathroom tiles pouring onto the bedspread. Green Teeth Murdoch, standing in the middle of the office, stepped back and fired a new burst of automatic gunfire into the alcove, the PI barely brushing the mattress before sliding into the narrow gap between the bed and the wall, taking cover from the bullet storm. A round of ammo or a piece of shrapnel tipped over the bottle of bourbon on the upside-down carton serving as a bedside table. Behind the bed, reeking with adrenaline, Kimrian took some quick, deep breaths and set out to execute their plan for survival. Step one, plug in the extension cord. Step two, yank the bedsheets and search the bundle for the revolver. Fire ceased. A rare, quivering silence took over the room. Kimrian found their gun and flipped it in their hands.
"Is this loaded?"
They pulled the trigger and fired a bullet into the brick wall. A new burst of submachine gun fire immediately zeroed into that same exact square foot, splashing Campbell's soup chunks of brownstone everywhere.
"That was unbelievably fucking stupid," Kimrian judged,
hands squeezing the revolver, mouth counting down the seconds, chest heaving at the rate of the Uzi fire, which barely muffled the sandpaper voice of Green Teeth Murdoch screaming, "Where's my fucking money, you cheating, holy shit, okay, wait!
Dimwan takes a deep breath.
"That's the necklace thug, I suppose."
Kimrian. "Actually, that was Green Teeth Murdoch. Qualifies as a villain, but yeah, he still counts."
Dimwan.
"Okay, forget it."
Adrian.
Kimrian.
"Yes?"
Dimwan.
"Take me back."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.